This is Concept E Classes, and today we'll study Chapter 1 of History in Class 8 Social Science, How, When and Where. So in this chapter, first we'll see how important are dates. There are three subtopics under this. Which dates are important? How do we periodize our history? What is colonial? Then we'll see how do we know about our past? Through records produced by the British administration, through surveys, and what do these official records do not tell. So this is just an introductory chapter for the whole book, which is our past three. First, let's see what is history. History is about the changes that occur over a time. For example, if we consider the progression of a man, here we can understand how humans have evolved over a period of time. So history is a study of past. It is about finding how things were in the past and how things have changed. As we compare the past with the present, we refer to time, we talk of before and after. Now, why should we study history? History allows us to understand our past, thereby helping us to understand our present. For example, before any form of transportation, humans travelled on foot. Then they started using animals, and then was the invention of wheel. Because of the invention of wheel in the past, we are now being able to travel easier and faster. So by understanding our past, it in turn helped us to understand our present. Now there is a common notion that history is always associated with dates. For example, here itself, the first question that comes to our mind is, when was wheel invented? So commonly we can say that history is associated with dates. Now let's see how dates are important in history. Now, the first topic of this chapter is how important are dates. There was a time when historians were fascinated with dates, and there were heated debates about the dates on which the rulers were crowned or the battles were fought. Dates are important as they note when certain events have happened. But in certain cases, it is impossible to fix precise dates to processes that happen over a period of time. For example, we cannot fix one single date on which the British rule was established. All these things have happened over a stretch of time. Then why do we continue to associate history with a string of dates? It is because there was a time when history was an account of battles and big events. It was about rulers and their policies. And historians, they used to write the year when a king was crowned, the year he was married, the year the next ruler succeeded to the throne. So for all these events like battles, the specific dates can be determined. For example, if we consider the third Mughal emperor Akbar, we can say that he was born on 15th October 1542. He died on 27th October 1605. So from all this, we can say that dates can be determined. But historians nowadays, they write only about a host of other issues and other questions, like how people earned their livelihood, how they produced and ate, how cities and markets developed, how kingdoms were formed, how new ideas spread, and how culture and societies changed. So we study that dates are important in history. Now, which dates are important, or what is the criteria required to choose a set of dates to be important? Let's see. The dates we select are not important on their own. For example, if we consider the day which we were born, is that date as important to any other historical dates? No. Dates become vital when we focus on a particular set of events as important. For example, if we consider the birthday of Jawaharlal Nehru, it's on 14 November and it's celebrated as Children's Day to give a tribute to our first Prime Minister. Now, why is that date important? Because he have contributed a lot to the children and youth of the country. He had ensured free education to all the children and also established many educational institutions. So from all these particular set of events, this day of Jawaharlal Nehru's birth have become important. Now let's take another example. If we consider the example of the histories written by the British historians in India, the rule of each British Governor General was important. These histories, they begin with the rule of the first Governor General, Warren Hastings, and ended with the last Viceroy, Lord Mountbatten. and there was a never-ending succession of governor generals and viceroys in India. Now, all the dates in the histories which are noted inside British India are based on the activities, policies and achievements linked to each of these personalities, and the chronology of their lives, each of these viceroys' lives, mark the different chapters of the history of British India. So we saw that each of the achievements made by the viceroys were marked as different chapters in the history of British India. So why do we need to divide it into chapters? It's because to give each chapter some coherence or some importance. Now, in histories that revolve around the life of the British governor generals, the activities of Indians simply do not fit. That is, generally the activities of Indians, they have no space in that. So what can be done? Clearly, we need another format for our history. Now, the next subtopic is how do we periodize? So before we enter into that, let's see why do we need to divide history into periods. Periodization helps us to understand the sequence in which various events occurred and their effects. It is actually an attempt to capture the characteristics of time, its central features as they appear to us. So with the help of periodization, we are able to differentiate between periods. So we'll see how we periodize, and after that we'll understand the concept of periodization. So in 1817, a historian named as James Mill, he was also a Scottish economist and a political philosopher, he published a massive 3-volume work or a book called as History of British India. And in that book, he divided the Indian history into 3 periods: the Hindu period, the Muslim period and the British period. This is James Mill. And this periodization, it came to be widely accepted. Now, according to Mill, his conceptions or his perspective was that all Asian societies were at a lower level of civilization than Europe. And before British came to India, Hindu and Muslim despots ruled the country. Religious intolerance, caste taboos and superstitious practices dominated the social life of Indians. And Mill felt that the British rule could civilize India. And he even thought that it was necessary to introduce European manners, arts, institutions and laws in India, and suggested that the British should conquer all the territories in India to ensure enlightenment and happiness of the Indian people. For India was not capable of progress without British help. So according to James Mill, he did not cherish any positive idea about India. He was of the opinion that all the activities that Indians do were lower as compared to that of European countries. So in his idea of history, the British rule, it represented all the forces of progress and civilization, and the period before British rule was one of the darkness. This was the perspective of Mill. Now, moving away from the British classification, the historians, they divided Indian history into ancient period, medieval period and modern period. Now, what is the ancient period? It is a time when the people were gatherers or hunters. That is a stage of early man. And all those ages like Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, they all come under the ancient period of Indian history. Now, what is a medieval period? Medieval period is a time when all the dynasties, about 3 whole centuries, the dynasties like Pandyas, Pallavas, Mughals, they came to rule and they flourished one after the another. Now, the modern period is the time or the period associated with the growth of all the forces of modernity. What are the forces of modernity? Science, reason, democracy, liberty and equality. And people started to fight or struggle for their freedom, for the equality. And all the movements like the formation of Indian National Congress, or the first war of Indian independence, or the Quit India movement, all took place during modern India. Now, this periodization was borrowed from the West. And this division also had its problems, because under British rule, the people did not have any equality, freedom or liberty. Moreover, the country also lacked the economic growth and progress in that period. And many historians refer to this period as colonial. Now let's see what is colonial. So the next subtopic is what is colonial. So as mentioned earlier, this chapter is actually an introduction for the rest of the chapters in this book. So we'll read about the way the British conquered the country. Now let's see how they established their rule. First, they subjugated the local Nawabs and Rajas. Then they collected revenue to meet all their expenses. The British brought goods they wanted at lower price, and they produced crops they needed for export. We will also study the changes the British rule brought about in values, the taste, custom and practices in the following chapters. So Britishers were trying to control India based on their opinions and their views. So when the subjugation of one country by another leads to these kind of political, economical, social and cultural changes, we refer the process as colonization. However, all classes and groups, they do not experience these changes in the same way. That is why this book is called as Our Past in Plural, and we'll study how these groups experience these changes in the following chapter. So how do we know about all this? We know what happened in the past by looking at the things from the past, including sources like books, newspapers, letters, artifacts like pottery, tools, human and animals remains, etc. So let's see how we were able to know about the British rule in India. So one important source to understand the British rule was the official records produced by the administration. The British believed that the act of writing was very important. Every instruction, plan, policy decision, agreement, investigation had to be clearly written up. And once this was done, they made memos, notings and reports so that they could be properly studied and debated. So the British also felt that all these important documents and letters need to be carefully preserved. So they set up record rooms attached to all administrative institutions like the village, Talsidar's office, the collectorate, the commissioner's office, the provincial secretaries, the law courts. Now this is one of the record rooms of Calcutta Mayor's Court. Similarly, specialized institutions like archives and the national museums were also established to preserve important records. This is the National Archives of India, which came up in 1920. And this is the museum situated in Kolkata in 1907. Letters, memos, notes and reports that the district officials prepared or the instructions can all be still read in the archives. Now, all these documents, they were carefully copied and beautifully written by calligraphers. Now, who are calligraphists? Calligraphists are those people who are specialized in the art of beautiful writing. See, if you see these letters, we can see they're written beautifully. So, by the middle of 19th century, with the spread of printing, multiple copies of these records were printed as proceedings of each government department. Hence, all these records were preserved properly. Now, another important source through which we are able to know all this were the surveys that were conducted at that time. Under the colonial administration, the practice of surveying also became common. The British believed that a country has to be properly known. That is, the British believed that first they should understand what all is there in the country before administrating it. So, for that, by early 19th century, detailed surveys were being carried out to map the entire country. In order to map the entire country, they started taking surveys. And in villages, revenue surveys were also conducted. So here if we see the image, we can see the instruments that were used to in surveys are placed in the foreground to emphasize the scientific nature of the project. So not only revenue surveys, the efforts were also made to know the topography, the soil quality, the flora, the fauna, the local histories and the cropping pattern of a region. So if you consider the image here, this is an image of a custard apple in 1770. The botanical gardens and the natural history museums, they established, which were established by the British, they collected plant specimens and information about their uses. And they told the local artist to draw pictures of these specimens. And the historians are now looking at the way such information was gathered and what information reveals about the nature of colonization. From the end of the 19th century, census operations were also held every 10 years. Census operations, they prepared detailed records of the number of people in all provinces of India, noting information on caste, religion and occupation. So census were taken every 10 years. This was the census of India in 1931. The Survey of India was established in 1761 to assist the British East India Company to map the territory for the purpose of administration. Now, there were many other surveys like botanical surveys, zoological surveys, archaeological surveys, anthropological surveys, forest surveys as well. So, the next subtopic is what official records do not tell. So, we studied that through official records, we're able to understand what happened during British administration. But the official records only tell us what the officials thought, what they were interested in, and what they wish to preserve for posterity. So, here if we look at the report to the Home Department, in 1946, the colonial government in India was trying to put down a mutiny that broke out on the ships of the Royal Indian Navy. Okay, and the reports that they received from different dockyards are like this. From Bombay, the report that they received was, the arrangements have been made for the army to take over the ship and establishment. From Karachi, 301 mutineers are under arrest and a few more strongly suspected are to be arrested. And from Vishakhapatnam, what the officer said was that the position is completely under control. So from all this, we can say that the official records, they only tell what the officials thought. And these records, they do not always help us to understand what other people or those people who were suffering or who broke down the mutiny felt and what they lay behind their actions. So for that, we need to look elsewhere. So these sources were more difficult to get than official records. And we used to get such resources from the diaries of peoples, account of pilgrims and travelers, autobiographies of important personalities, and popular booklets that were sold in local bazaars. And as the printing spread, newspapers were published and issues were debated in public. One such example is the report of a police strike in 1946. There, about 2,000 men, policemen in Delhi, they refused to take their food on Thursday morning as a protest against their low salaries and the bad quality of food supplied to the police lines, from the police lines. And as this news spread to other police stations, the men there also refused to take the food. And one of the strikers, they even said that this food, which is supplied from the police line kitchens, is not fit for human consumptions. So, after the publishing of newspapers, such debates were issued publicly. So, as the newspapers were published and as the printing spread, the leaders and reformers, they wrote to spread their ideas. The poets and novelists, they wrote to express their feelings. So all these resources, however, were produced only by those who were literate. We were not able to understand the history which was experienced by the people living in tribal areas, the peasants or the illiterate workers in mines or the poor on the street. So getting to know their lives is a much more difficult task. Yet this can be done if we make a little bit of effort. So if we study the following chapters in the book, we'll be able to see how this can be done. So that's all for the first chapter in history. This was just an introductory chapter for the whole book. Tune in soon for the next session. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Take care and bye-bye.